vision that we may know where to stand and what to stand for. Because unless we stand for something, we shall fall for anything. End quote. Are you someone who sees the glass half empty or as half full? Are you someone who sees the good in people, or do you become fixated on one flaw, one misdeed? Are you someone who sees something wrong and works to fix it, or who shrugs and figures, what's the point? It's not going to change anything. What do you see? Clearly, God sees a great deal. The Genesis text reminds us of the mystery and power of God. There is a lot of growing and maturing and birthing and nurturing and walking and swimming and flying in this first chapter of Genesis. And God said, there is light and there is night. And God saw that it was good. God's creative action through words is remarkable. And God said. I only wish my words would have such power, especially when the dishes need to be put away or the lawn mowed or clothes picked up from the floor. And Mom said, and only sometimes it happens. I'm limited in my powers. God's powers, on the other hand, are quite visionary and even transcendent. Associate Professor of Theology and Culture at Seattle School of Theology and Psychology, Professor Ron Ruthruff writes, quote, "Transcendence is a theological term, a 25-cent word, that simply means the existence beyond what is perceived as normal or human. This concept is incredibly difficult for those of us who grew up in the shadow of the Enlightenment and the corresponding advances in scientific discovery." End quote. With all that we know, it is hard not to get caught up in the literal interpretation of creation. How do we embrace the mystery of this story that God is other and not like us? As Ruthruff says, quote, "How do we read it in a way that builds our faith and helps us avoid the way of thinking that seeks certainty and control?" God is at work. I cannot control God, nor can I contain God. I trust in this process, and yet that does not mean I should not question or challenge. When we embrace the mystery of God and what God can do, we lean into our own gifts and abilities that we too are something more that God has intended. When we embrace the mystery of God, we lean into our vision of what we hope to be and do, much like God did when God said. Sarah Jewell, in her book, Alphabets of Faith, writes that, quote, "Vision isn't just the physical sight we have, it's also our values and our personal plan for what is most important to us. This applies to each of us as individuals, but also to all of us as a community of faith. Our common values and our common plan for what is most important as followers of Jesus living in the 21st century. If the season of Lent asks us to look inside ourselves and to reflect upon how we are living, then the season of Pentecost, which begins with a reminder that we are disciples of Jesus in a world that needs more Jesus, the season of Pentecost asks us to look around ourselves and to see how our living affects others. Nothing changes if we refuse to see. Systems don't change. Revolutions don't happen. Jesus doesn't fulfill his promise if we refuse to see, if we choose. values and our common mission, which is, as always, to love one another through justice and mercy and kindness and peace. Now, as you recall, last fall, we created our mission priorities for our congregation: faith formation and spiritual life, community outreach, children, youth, and young adults, and seniors. Now, does our vision that we came up with in 2017 apply? Because we had that conversation in 2017, and then we developed these mission priorities again as we're trying to figure out what are we going to look like as we come out of the pandemic. Our vision is what's printed in the inside of your bulletin cover every single Sunday. We embrace and encourage faith, love, children, and community. And our values that guide us on our journey are open, affirming, welcoming, and inclusive, and generous and supportive. I think our vision and our values that were initially put into place in 2017 are pretty close. The church council will discuss this and share with you any tweaks in the process. And as we think about all this and how this works, I ask for your input as well, as we need to ensure and to be mindful that how our current mission priorities fit with our values, our vision, are they aligned so that we can continue to do this work? And then there's the ultimate question, why does any of this matter? The mystery of where we are headed as a congregation or even as the church universal can be exciting if we let the transcendence of God wash over us. Julian Lesheser, senior minister of University Church in Chicago, writes, quote, "Global health crises, changing political landscapes, economic upheaval, and racial reckonings are but a few of the real chances we have as the church to mark the world with the imprint of God. And if we think people leading us will all need to have a PhD, we are not the only ones fooling ourselves, but costing ourselves precious time. What our church needs are people who can help elicit trust and speak to our deepest yearnings. We need congregations that address realities with the boldness and faithfulness of the one whom we claim inspires us. We need lay people and clergy who are emboldened to speak the truth of God within the church's walls and at the gates of empire. Congregations need to trust themselves to be the image of God, to envision it, to move toward it, to adjust the contours and the scribble in the margins. The church at Pentecost was filled with an energy and the Spirit that could not be seen, but certainly could be felt, much like it is today. As we step into this transcendent vision, I am once again reminded of Reinhold Niebuhr's prayer. God, give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things that should be changed, and wisdom to distinguish the one from the other. Acceptance and serenity, Ron Luther writes, sit in deep contrast of knowing and certainty. Acceptance and serenity embrace the limitations of being human and rely on the otherness of God. May we move forward with the vision to see what God